here are the few things that I want to tell you, and you have to promise me you will do it. Is that okay? Sure, no? You have to tweet my picture with Amish. All of you should tweet it, okay? क्योंकि इसी बहाने मेरे भी कुछ किताब बिक जाएंगे. Amish's book has sold, he told me, 3.5 million copies. He is the number one author in this country. So I'm extremely glad that he is here. I'm here to have a fun conversation. Amish, is that the deal? Yeah, because मैंने तो कोई prepare नहीं किया. I'm just going to have a conversation.
I shall try my best.
Thank you. So here is how we managed to get Amish. I'm here because Sandeepan Deb, who's the editor of Swaraj, a very dear friend of mine, and I said, he said, Feroz, if I tell Amish to do anything, he will do it. I'm like, boss, what does that mean? And then he told me the story of how our dear friend wrote his first book and got rejected by 20 publishers. 20 publishers rejected this book. 20 publishers. And then you know the rest is history. And my friend Sandeepan played a small role, I hope, in helping this a massive success. And that's why Sandeepan says, you know what, if I ask Amish to be there, he will be there. Thank you, Sandeepan. Thank you, Amish, for gracing this
one. My pleasure, my pleasure. And Sandeepan sadly is not here. He's in Delhi, he's fallen ill. So may I request you guys applaud loud enough so that he can hear it in Delhi. Loudly, loudly, loudly. For Sandeepan.
So I'm just supposed to ask question and keep my mouth shut. So my first question to you is, tell us the story of how did this become such a massive success? From the time you wrote, I know you is a deeply religious person, by the way. But from the time he wrote, did he ever actually think this will become the kind of success it has? Take us through that journey.
No, before that, I must say, honestly, you are right. I said yes because of Sandeepan. Sandeepan just emailed with a CC to Feroz, and I just said yes. I can't say no to Sandeepan, and I just said yes. But I've come here and I've seen this program and what you've built up, and what I'm seeing out here is just so wonderful. You know, and he gave me such a wonderful insight. It's about changing the context. You know, there are some people, sadly, who don't even want to help. But there are some people who want to help, but their attitude is not right, because they think in terms of, we are more fortunate, someone else is less fortunate, we have to try and help. And then wo ego aa jata hai. But here, what I'm seeing is the stage that has been set, the confidence that one sees, the attitude of even those who are not disabled, even their attitude changes. And that is truly changing the context. So you need to applaud the work that he is doing. It is, and more power to this wonderful work. And we need to do this in India. If India needs to revive and take its rightful place in the comity of nations again, every single Indian must walk this journey.
Thank you for doing this great service for our country, for the country that I love.
Thank you. Now, this book, basically, Immortals of Melua, every single publisher who read it said, yaar, ye toh guaranteed flop hai. It's a guaranteed flop because they said it's based on a religious subject. And the main market in today's India are the youth. And I was told that the youth aren't really interested in religion. So that's why they rejected it. So I self-published the first book in association with my agent. When we published it, frankly, I didn't know where it was going to go. I had absolutely zero idea. But God's grace, it did very well. And I'm as surprised as anyone else. So I'm living a dream. Don't wake me up.
Thank you so much.
In fact, I should tell you, you know, before writing Immortals of Melua, I'd written absolutely no fiction ever in my life, ever. Not even a short story in school, absolutely nothing. The only things I'd written were some poetry in college for my girlfriend in those days, who's now my wife.
Okay, and let's hear a big round of applause for that.
And
you got one thing going right in your life.
And the poems were horrible. Nobody liked them except for my girlfriend, who's now my wife, because she likes anything that I do. So most of my school and college friends who meet me, they tell me, yaar, sach bata, actually kisne likha hai? Tu to nahi likh sakta hai.
Thank you. Now, tell me one thing. People think you are a fantastic, I know you have, you know, I am Calcutta graduate, so there is a little bit of marketing in your blood somewhere. But he's an incredible marketing guy. This is probably the first book that has a movie kind trailer. So tell me about the whole marketing aspect behind a book. Do you think it's an important vehicle for books to sell?
Marketing is important no matter what you do. So even the noble mission that you are driving,
yep,
unless marketing is put into it to make it visible, you know, to as many people as possible, it's not going to achieve everything that it can do. One of the fallacies that many people believe is that a good product sells itself. Sadly, aisa nahi hota hai. It needs to be marketed well as well.
Yeah.
And for that, you need, it's not so much about money, frankly.
Yeah.
It's about good ideas.
Yeah.
You know, and fortunately, I had a very good bunch of advisors. My wife, who is also a very close advisor, I had friends like Abhijit Podwal, you know, various people like them who actually gave me some very good ideas, which worked well for us. So like, for example, for the first book, we distributed the first chapter of the book free of cost with the same cover as the cover of the main book. This was distributed in many retail stores as a sampler.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like how you have those shampoo sachets, right? Have you seen that? I mean, you might not want to spend 100 rupees for a shampoo bottle, but 1 rupee for a shampoo sachet, yeah, try kar lete hain yaar, dekhte hain, it might work. Correct. So that's what the idea of that first chapter was. It's a sampler, try it out. If it works, come back and buy the book. We tried that, it worked very well for us.
Fantastic. Tell me one thing, now I want to get to the, a little bit, and you have touched this in your book, is the aspect of gods with disabilities, right? Can you share a little bit of thinking behind saying someone like a Ganesha is also having a kind of disability? So what's your perspective on disability from a point what you've written in your book?
One is the perspective of gods like God Ganesh, Lord Ganesh, and you know, Goddess Kali within the book is made as a result of a medicine that their parents took. This was based on, you know, it's an idea that struck me based on a scientific research paper I'd read many years ago. You must have heard of that thalidomide, right?
Yes.
The medicine. Those of you who haven't heard of it, thalidomide was considered a wonder drug in the 1960s in the US, and it was supposed to be a drug which cured morning sickness. Morning sickness is something, you know, pregnant women suffer, and those of us who are supportive husbands, they also suffer it along with the pregnant wives. And thalidomide was supposed to take away that morning sickness completely. What they discovered over a few years is that mothers who had taken thalidomide during morning sickness, randomly, some of the children would be born with some or the other disability. You know, say a leg missing, or you know, some problem with the heart, or you know, an extra arm on the shoulder, things like that. It was an idea that remained in my mind that a chemical external medicinal intervention in your body can lead to something like this. So that's where this idea emerged from. And the point is how society looks at them. And I think if we can actually look at them as gods, then like you were saying, the entire context changes. And because in the traditional Indian way, God is not something or someone who is external. God is something which exists within every single one of us. Not just human beings, but in all animals, all the nature, the river, this chair, everything. Everything has God within. If you imbibe this concept, your entire concept changes. Because you'll instinctively respect everyone else. Because you're seeing God in that person. Then the entire approach changes. And perhaps that's where this idea comes from. That we have to, if we can see God in everything, we ourselves actually become much nicer people.
Fantastic insight, Amish. One more thing, and we were discussing this, is the idea of giving, the idea of charity. And you had shared some very interesting insights. I just want you to share the same thing about how do you dissolve ego and how is that fundamentally different from the idea of giving that we have today. Can you share your thoughts, Amish?
Yeah, I mean, this is something based on ancient Indian concepts. And I'm not saying it's easy. Like I honestly, you know, confess to you that I myself also sometimes get into this mindset that I am a lucky person, you know, I must try and help those less unfortunate. It's very easy to get into that conversation. And that actually is a negative conversation, because even if you're trying to help, your attitude may be such that the other person may not like it, even when you're trying to help. How can this attitude change? And there is this modern paradigm of charity, which we see, where those doing charity have a certain amount of ego about themselves. That look at me, I am so great, I am doing good for others. You know, some of the really terrible ones will say, you know, I should get a photograph shot of how much of a check I'm giving, you know, so that I get recognized. You know, so you're doing it more for ego. Sometimes it happens, there was an article that I was telling you, I'd read in The Economist, that the people receiving charity also get into a negative mind frame. There are some who become charity addicts because they keep wanting charity. They don't try and build their own life. The traditional Indian approach was completely different, because in the modern approach, it's believed that the person giving charity is doing a favor. Yeah. The person receiving charity is receiving a favor. Yeah. In the traditional Indian way, it's the exact opposite. Because the concept of karma changes your mind completely. See, karma is something that you carry, only you, no one else. You carry your own karma. You don't carry anyone else's karma through this life and the next. Which means you carry karmic goods that you've done. You carry it through all your lives. You carry karmic debt as well. If you've taken help from someone, you're carrying karmic debt, correct? Which you'll have to repay in this life or the next. If you see it from this perspective, then the person giving charity is actually receiving a favor, because he has wiped out his karmic debt, correct? He has reduced his karmic debt. So his attitude is of gratefulness, that you are receiving charity from me. Thank you. You've helped me wipe out my karmic debt. The person receiving charity also has a different attitude, because in his mind, he's thinking, I have taken on a karmic debt. I need to wipe this out. I need to help someone else. Correct? So the entire approach flips over. Like I can give you an example of my family. It's not something that I hide. It's something I'm very proud of. I come from a very humble family. We've risen from humble beginnings. And our family has risen a lot because of the charity of this great man called Madan Mohan Malviyaji. I'm sure all of you have heard of him. He was the founder of BHU, of Banaras Hindu University. He used to do charity for a lot of people. One of the people who benefited from his support was my grandfather, who was of limited means but very intelligent. And our entire family has an attitude because of this. We, of course, idolize Madan Mohan Malviyaji, but we have an attitude that we have received a karmic debt, we have to help others. That's the only way we'll wipe out our karmic debt. So, you know, so the thing is, the entire attitude flips over if you come with the attitude of karma. The person receiving charity is actually doing a favor to the person giving charity, because he's taking a karmic debt on his soul.
Fantastic. Incredible insight. Incredible. So, Amish, I'm going to ask you the next question and you have to give an honest answer, okay? And we will probably, you guys can tweet it, okay? Because I don't think he has answered
I that. Will suggest if you can tweet it or not, depending on the question.
So, is there a Bollywood movie happening on the Shiva Trilogy? And if yes, who's the actor and who's the actress? Can you tell that, please?
Okay. There are discussions on. In fact, there's a discussion on for a TV series as well. And hopefully, we'll have a TV series or a movie that's worthy of Lord Shiva. Actor, actresses, it's too early to say. Yeah. Let's see.
Anybody who wants to be part of that, can you please raise your hand? Right to that?
Yeah, yeah, just he's all names to him. I will ensure the suggestions are passed on.
Okay. No, fantastic. You know, we normally don't do this, but I am happy to take a few questions from the audience. So, is that okay? We were not prepared for this, but I hope it's okay, Amish.
I'm completely okay. If there's a mic,
I see a hand there.
Go around.
So I don't know if there's a running microphone, because we normally don't take questions.
Oh, there is someone with a mic out there.
But there's a microphone there. So
out there. Yeah, there's a girl out there.
Perfect.
Go for it.
You can come forward and ask the question, and Amish or myself, I can repeat it.
There you go. The mic's reaching you.
First is an honest confession. I haven't read your book yet.
Shame on you.
But that's joking, for everybody here who hasn't read it, and I will not confess. So I just wanted them to be a part of this question. So So this is something my family has been doing, and we were reading the Ramayana for the first time. I'm Hindu by birth, but not by anything else. So we were reading through the Ramayana, and we were reading about the part where they talk of Lord Shiva coming to marry Parvati. There's a small description about it. And they talk of Lord Shiva as the god of death and darkness and all the things that people are scared of. And most other religious people who do not understand Hinduism, you know, disregard this aspect of Hinduism, where they say, oh, they make people scared for them to believe in God. And I don't understand it. But they describe the Bharat of Lord Shiva as full of ghosts and people who have two heads, three hands, ugly bodies that you are scared to look at. Even Lord Shiva's own image is quite scary, I would say. So I'm sure you would have done some research while working on this book. And do you have, I mean, my family felt that this was the writer's way of describing that Lord Shiva was the one who had the truly inclusive self. Like, he had included people who the society had rejected. And then we could not take the discussion anywhere because we didn't know much about it. So have you done any research on this? Would you like to share something about this?
Lovely, lovely question. Very intelligent question. Technically, Lord Shiva is not the god of death. It's Lord Yam who is the god of death. But Lord Shiva is kind of like the conqueror. You know, those who worship to him can conquer death due to his blessing.
Yeah,
but the way to see Lord Shiva is, sometimes he's described as a god of destruction.
That's true.
But the best way to understand him is, he's not the god of destruction. He's actually the god of transformation. Okay, you have to see how the concept of time is in the Indian way as compared to the modern, more westernized way. The modern Western approach to time is linear. There's a beginning and there's an end. Correct? The Indian concept of time is circular.
There is
no beginning and end. Okay? If you have a linear approach to time, then death is a very scary thing. Correct? Because, man, that's the end of it all. And then after that, that's the afterlife where you could be in hell forever or heaven forever. Correct? But if you're approaching it from a circular perspective, then what is a beginning? What is an end? Correct? The way to understand it is, actually there is no death. There is only transformation. Nothing ever escapes the universe. When all of us will die sometime. When we die, what will happen? Our bodies, they're made of chemicals. We will decompose and we'll form something else once again. Our bodies, correct? Our genes will pass on through our children. And our soul, it can be seen as energy, will find some purpose once again, either another living being or in moksha. So you, what you are seeing as you, is a temporary coming together of three forces, which will carry on their journey forever and ever, because it's a great, you know, circle.
Yeah.
If you approach it from this perspective, then what's there to be so afraid of about death? It's not the end of anything. It's just a transformation. It's like a long sleep. And this is not just the ancient Indian way. This is the way of ancient peoples across the world. In ancient Greece, death was often referred to as the long sleep. There's a short sleep, which you wake up from every night, and death is a long sleep. That's it. There's nothing to be so afraid of. And lastly, in terms of that Shivji ki Bharat, yes, this is a... Bharat is a Hindi word for wedding procession.
Wedding procession.
And this is a term that's popular in North India as well. Shivji ki Bharat, anyone can join. Okay, and that is one of the things that I think, I'm by nature a rebellious person, by nature a slightly anti-elitist person. So those of us who are rebellious, that's why we find Lord Shiva very attractive. Because as they say in Banaras, jiska koi nahi, uska Bhagwan Shiv hai. He who has no one has Lord Shiva. Because he doesn't differentiate, he doesn't care between highborn and lowborn. Don't differentiate between men, women. Don't differentiate between devas, asuras. He doesn't care. If you're good, if you're doing your duty, he'll bless you, and you can join his Bharat. So, join Shivji's Bharat.
That answers my question.
Thank you.
Very well. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Amish, मुझे लग रहा है कि you know Shivji की Bharat and India Inclusion Summit में एक similarity है. Here also anybody can join.
Perfect.
आ जाओ.
हर हर महादेव.
We are in it together. Everybody is part of this. Fantastic. I have one more question and you have to make it really short, okay? Ask the question.
Sorry? All of us are Shiva here.
Oh.
Shiva exists in all of us. You realize it and you join the Bharat. Some of us don't realize that Shiva is in us.
Hello.
There's one lady there.
Hello.
Yeah. Shout.
Okay.
That you're carrying what? Okay, let's be honest. Let's be honest. I'm not, you know, obviously that thing can be implemented better. But as a society, have we tolerated dishonesty for long? Yes. As a society, let's be honest, do we vote for people who we know are dishonest? Yes. We like to assume that dishonest politicians win due to rigging. Let's be honest, they win because they have support. All of us, we are blind to it. If there's a red traffic signal at 1 a.m. in the night, how many of us will say there's no other car, but I will still wait because it's red? No, because we'll say, I'm breaking a small rule. What difference does it make? So I'm not saying that the line should be there. Things need to be better run, of course. But can a country become a little more intolerant of dishonesty? I would say yes, we can. And we ourselves need to be the change. As Mahatma Gandhi correctly said, we need to be the change that we want to see. We ourselves have to be honest in everything that we do. Then we can demand it of others. Matlab, raat ke ek baje bhi hai, laal batti hai, to rukna hai. Agar line mein hai, to rukna hai. We ourselves should follow it completely. Then we have the right to demand it of others. So many of us point fingers at our politicians. Can we point at ourselves that we ourselves are honest all the time? That's a point I want to leave. No. I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that at all. That is something that has a problem with the infrastructure and the administration. That has to be handled. I'm talking about us pointing fingers at others before we look at ourselves. That's the point I'm trying to make. Let's look at ourselves first, then certainly point fingers at others. But even Jesus Christ said this, right? Before you throw stones at others, look at ourselves first. Are we completely honest in everything of our life? And time out, so I'm going to follow the rules.
Thank you so much. I think we are running out of time, but let me ask one last question. Is this a trilogy as well?
It's probably 5 books, actually. That's why I've called it series.
Series, yeah. That's why, I know. So yeah. It's 5 books.
Yeah.
On behalf of the India Inclusion Summit, I wish this to sell at least 10 million copies.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Let's give a big round of applause to Amish. Thank you. Thank you, Amish. Thank you so much.